Welcome to another edition of Sound of Spurs podcast presented by HEB. This is edition number 10 and a very, very special guest, the only Spur to be a homegrown Spur. And we'll talk more about that with Devin Brown. Man, Devin, there's so much to talk about and I don't even know where to begin, but let's start at the very beginning. I didn't realize this till I was looking up your bio that you were actually born in Salt Lake City.
I was born. Yeah. A lot of people don't know that. I was born in Utah. My mom was up there, you know, working at Hill Air Force Base, and moved down to San Antonio maybe when I was about 6 or 7 months old. So I've been in San Antonio ever since then.
So you don't remember Salt Lake City except for the games that you played there?
No. The first time I went back, I was asked for about 18 to 20 tickets. Wow. Did not know any of them. Left the tickets for him at will call, met him after the game, played a decent game, had a big dunk that game with San Antonio. Cause I never got a chance to play there in college. Yeah. Let me look back. No, we didn't have BYU on the schedule. No. Yeah. So with the Spurs, that was my first time back, and met him after the game. And all I could say was, well, nice to meet you guys.
And these were relatives of yours?
Yeah, on my dad's side of the family.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, my dad was in Denver for a little bit, and but mainly he was in that Ogden, the Salt Lake City area. So, yeah, you know, lots of family on his side that were up there.
Oh, cool. Well, let's start at the beginning, because I think most people remember you or first heard of you when you were at West Campus High School, breaking all kinds of records at West Campus. Growing up in San Antonio, going to West Campus High School, were you a Spurs fan back then? Did you get to go to games or watch games on TV?
Yeah, so that's very interesting that you're asking me that. I was a Spurs fan. My sister actually was a ball girl, if that makes sense, ball boy, whatever you want to call them. She did that for the 99 season. And you remember that season, you know, that was the first championship.
So,
you know, I was there in the finals, my mom and myself, she'd leave us tickets. And so we were a part of that, seeing the games, you know, in the Alamo Dome. I know that's a big deal coming up on Friday. And so I you know, I did that in high school. You know, your parents want you to get a job, and I got a job, and one of them was being a Spurs coordinator. I was one of the coaches for the San Antonio Spurs camp. So I spent a lot of time, four summers doing that, and would see all the players, you know, coming in there. Now, Bill, I'm not calling anybody out, but on occasions, some of the players were running a little behind or got confused on time. So at the camp, the kids did not understand that. Right. So as coaches, we had to buy them time, you know, playing games like knockout. I work with Neville Shedd. Neville Shedd has been with that Spurs part of the organization for almost 30 years now. He hired me as one of the coaches, and had a great time doing it. So I've always had that Spurs connection. But we'll get into where it really came in later.
Well, I got a chance to do some of your college games, because when you were UTSA, I was at the University of Texas.
Right.
And I know that the Roadrunners would come up and play the Longhorns. But you had quite a career at UTSA. In fact, you recorded the first triple-double ever in history for the school in a game against Northeast Louisiana, or Louisiana Monroe, whatever they were calling it back then. It's Louisiana Monroe now. 33 points, 11 boards, 11 assists. And that was on February 17th of 01. That was a big, big breakout game for you. Of course, you already had been having a pretty good career. But what do you remember about that triple-double?
Well, when you were just talking about it, I was wondering where the third category was going to come from. I didn't know if it was steals or blocks, but the fact that you said 11 assists, I'll tell you right now, if we were to call all my teammates from that roster, they probably don't remember those 11 assists. UTSA, no, not at all. When I got to UTSA, I let them know as a freshman that I was not there to make a whole lot of passes. I was there for scoring and to get us to the NCAA tournament, which I did one out of four times. So, you know, that didn't go as well as I thought. But, you know, I lost a couple of we got to the championship every year, but I lost a couple of them on some buzzer beaters. but that happens in March Madness, right?
Absolutely. And that was the Southland Conference back then, right? Because I know the UTSA
Southland Conference
has changed conference affiliation several times throughout the years, but during your period of time was the Southland Conference.
Yeah, it was the Southland. I wish. I'll tell you what, I just wish that we would have been anywhere near Conference USA. That would have been a lot of fun for me. No football team back then, so we were the biggest thing on campus. But, you know, like you said, you know, let's go back to that memorable night against them. That was one of our rivals, you know, when it came to college. And, you know, so to throw those kind of numbers up, those sound really good. 33-11-11. You know, it meant a lot to our team. And, you know, I'm joking about the whole assist thing, but I'm telling you what, when I was walking on campus there, you know, I got criticized a lot from my teammates for not passing, but hey, we'll deal with it, right?
I remember doing a pregame interview with Rick Barnes, the Texas coach at the time, and you guys were coming up to play at Longhorns, and he said, number one thing we got to do is worry about this Devin Brown guy. And right. I specifically remember that because you were the Southland Conference Freshman of the Year, the three-time Conference Player of the Year. You finished at UTSA as the all-time leading scorer. Mm-hmm. And you just mentioned the fact that football wasn't around back then for UTSA. So how has that campus, how has the athletic department in that university changed over the last two decades since you played?
You know, I've gotten a chance to walk the campus since they've done all that. I happened to be up there on a Friday back when Brooks Thompson was coaching the team. He wanted me to come to practice and just be a part of what it is that they did, and I did that. And we were getting out of practice on a Friday, and I said, you know what, I'm going to walk back on campus, go up the big stairs. All the Roadrunners, you know exactly what I'm talking about when I say the big stairs leading to the campus. So when I walked out of the back of the Convocation Center, it was students from there all the way to the big stairs. They were hosting a pep rally for the football team. I thought that was amazing because I had no idea. And I don't think a lot of people even know that they do that on Fridays. They have the big pep rally for the football team. And I thought, you know what, that would have been a great experience to be a part of that. But what we did at UTSA in the time that I was there, it set the table, you know, for the university to have the success that they have now. Not taking, you know, any of the credit, just laying down the foundation. And now to, you know, man, if I'm, you know, 17, 18 years old, walking in on campus as an incoming freshman now, I have to be excited. You know, back then it was more of a commuter school. And so a lot of people didn't live on campus. And now, you know, in that surrounding area, UTSA Boulevard, it's on. It's very lively on an everyday basis. And, you know, I'm very excited for those kids, and they need to be excited, you know, as a basketball team, you know, just in the fact that there's a lot of resources out there now. And I'm happy for UTSA as a whole.
Your jersey is retired by UTSA. How special is that for you? And also the fact that, you know, that you'll always be remembered by the young athletes coming up and the people that go to the games and see your jersey up there.
Well, it's a easy recruiting tool for me, you know, when I'm taking some of these high school players to the game and, you know, I tell them, hey, look up, what's that say? And they're like, you know, they see the Brown 23 and they're like, coach, is that you? I'm like, well, I don't know any too many more Brown 23. So it's gotta be me. But yeah, it's exciting, man. I got a chance to go to the game a couple weeks ago. They played North Texas, had a great time, caught myself looking at it a couple of times and just going down memory lane, things like that. So it's great. I tell you what, I enjoyed my 4 years when I was there. I wouldn't change that for anything. And, you know, we got a lot done, you know, while I was there, and to see that school doing the things that they're doing now and going into another conference, you know, here in a couple of years, just a lot of great things happening for the school.
You know, Dev, one of the cool things about doing this show, and this is our 10th episode, is we've had a chance to visit with guys about their basketball journeys. And right. Everyone is different, right? Every journey is a little bit different. So now we get to the fact that you're not drafted in 02. And right. Now the real fun begins for Devin Brown. Okay, so I don't want to get in the way. I want you to kind of take me through all the stuff that went on because you, my friend, are a guy that paid his dues.
I did. So, you know, here we go. It's the night of the draft. And the Spurs have the last two picks, and I'm not expecting to get picked. I mean, I wasn't expecting to play at that level, you know, at the time. And, you know, that didn't happen. And the next day I get a phone call from a guy named Francis Flax out of Salina, Kansas. And he said, "We drafted you number one overall into the USBL. I don't know if any of our viewers, well, some of the viewers will remember that league. But a 3-month league. And, you know, when you sit down and you go over it with your agent on, you know, well, why go to this league or things like that? Well, it's a chance to play basketball. And being that it's a 3-month league, your goal is to try and make an NBA summer league team. So that's what I did. I went down there, you know, we're practicing at Southern Nazarene. You ever heard of that?
I have heard of Nazarene, Southern Nazarene. Yeah. Not a big school.
Not a big school, not a big town. Hey, listen, when that Walmart goes, that alarm on top of Walmart goes off, it's get to the Walmart, get to shelter, because something's coming in that you don't want to be a part of. So
about tornadoes now, right?
Yeah. Stayed right there at the Hampton Inn across the street from that Walmart. Played well. We got to the championship game, had 51 in the championship game. And of all people that were in the stands, RC Buford was at that game.
How about that?
Right. But you're still not thinking that something's going to happen after that. So didn't hear anything from San Antonio. I went to summer league with the Washington Wizards. We had 18 guys for two spots. And I was one of the two that made that team. Went up there, very young team at the time. Guys like Jared Jeffries, Juan Dixon, Brendan Haywood, Eton Thomas.
Eton Thomas, the poet. Eton wrote poetry, right, Dev?
He did. He was the same way he is now. He was then back then. His teammates would give him a lot of a hard time for that, but that's just who he was. Extremely nice guy. Mm-hmm. You know, you run across, and you know this, Bill, you've been in the NBA a long time. You run across some of these guys, they're big, they're tough, but when you get off the court with them, they're completely different. And that's who he was. And so, you know, I was able to do that. Do you want me to continue with that?
Yeah, well, because it kind of goes back and forth, because the D League was not very well known back then, and it was called the D League and not the G League. It was called the NBDL, as a matter of fact, the NBA Development League. You became part of that as well, right?
I did. So, you know, like if we go back a couple of paces there's not many people that know this story when it comes to one of the last games I was with the Wizards. You remember how they used to do it in Boston, the summer league? Teams were going off, teams were coming on. Yep. Well, we were going off, and the Spurs were coming on, and Budenholzer taps me on the shoulder, and he's like, "Hey, you're the kid from San Antonio." I said, "Yes, sir." And he goes, "Hey, why don't you come work out with us sometime?" And ran off. He didn't give me a location. He didn't tell me any times. And he didn't tell me when. So I'm like, okay. So I get back to San Antonio, and I'm sitting there, and I'm like, well, I know they used to practice at Incarnate Word, but I think they have a new facility. And the facility, the apartment that I was staying in by UTSA off of USA Boulevard, it was a block over.
Wow.
So that first day I walk over there, and the very first person I see when I'm getting ready to go into the building, this is before they had the thumbprint. Yeah, you know what I'm talking about, Bill. Yeah.
Got to get in.
This was before that. They had just
high security.
Yeah. It was the empty parking lot. I made my reservations at Luby's because all that was wide open. So I made my reservations for Luby's. I said, listen, I'm going to come in here. Give me about a couple of hours. I'm going to go in here and play with the Spurs. Mm-hmm. All right. Right. And so I go in there, and the very first person I see is David Robinson.
Wow.
The very first person. So you talk about intimidated. He turns around and he's like, welcome. And I'm like, I know he could see my heart. We probably picked it up, put it back in my chest. But I go in there, and, you know, from that day forward, I end up going to training camp with them, you know. But, you know, when you talk about the G League, in 03, you know, I went to training camp with San Antonio. Had a great summer, you know, working out with those guys. I worked out for them with about 2 months. And one day I was leaving, and the big man called me. I was halfway through the parking lot, and I turned around, and it was Greg Popovich. And he said, hey, you want to come to training camp with us? I said, absolutely. And he said, did you have any plans for what you were going to do? And I said, yeah, I was going to actually work at HEB. And he asked me how much they were paying me. I said, $12 an hour. And he said, I think I can pay you a little bit more than that. I don't want to go through this whole thing with your agent. Would you like to join our team? I said, yes. And 2 days later, we were in Paris for training camp. Mm-hmm. So we went through training camp. Training camp was good. But here comes that last preseason game, right? Mm-hmm. And Pop calls me in his office, and he's just looking at me, and he's like, young fella, the numbers aren't right with this. And I said, no, I understand. He said, but you did a heck of a job, and we'll keep our eye on you. And I remember walking out of that office, and, you know, you're in a situation where you haven't let anybody down because it's the NBA. But you want to get back to that, you know, you want to get back to the, you know, flying in the middle of the night and things like that. You know, not having to check in the hotels, the cards are right there on the table for you. You want to get back to that. So yes, I go to the G League. Now, Bill, the interesting thing about this is when you get down there and you go through your physical, this was one of the first years they did the G League. So guess what? You have 400 players at one location that all have to go through physicals. So you have 12 stations or however many stations they had, and that line, you're talking to everybody. So whenever you get done with the physical is when you get on the bus and you go to whatever city you're at. Crazy. And at that time, it was some – there were some cities that were very far from Atlanta.
And you ended up in Fayetteville. Is that right?
Ended up with Fayetteville. Jeff Capel. That's a legendary name. His cool. son, Jason, played for UNC.
Yep.
Jeff Capel kind of, you know, I get down there. He gives me the keys. He said, hey, this is your team. You're coming from San Antonio. We know you're not going to be down here long, but you get these guys extra shots. Stay after practice, all the things that you need to do, because everybody that's there in that roster build, you want to get to the NBA. And if you go down there and you mess around or you don't take care of your business, you're going to get stuck there, and then you're going to be out of the rotation. So I got down there, and Jeff was great. He was absolutely great. Legendary coach. His wife would fix neck bones for me. That was I love neck bones, and
that's a Southern thing, isn't it? neck bones.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I don't know if you know anything, but yeah, pork. Yeah, pork neck
okay.
bones. Yeah,
I got you. Good. Okay.
and there in the South, they're huge oxtails, you know, things like that. So his wife would fix those for me, I had some great teammates. One of the teammates that a lot of people don't know about is Matt Barnes. Matt Barnes and I spent a lot of time together getting shots up before and after practice, competing, you know, one-on-one, things like that. So we got down there, you know, we were trying to get out of there as quick as we could, but Jeff Capel did do a great job of making it, you know, comfortable for us.
You were the MVP that year, if I'm not mistaken, of the entire league.
Had a great year. You know, Coach Capel put me on the block, So I was a guy that scored from the outside, scored from the inside.
You're posting up at 6'5"? You're a 6'5" post-up guy?
6'5", 230, a big guard.
Yeah, you know? Yeah, you were a big guard. Yeah,
big guard. So I like to bang bodies. PJ Carlissimo used to give me a lot of grief and a lot of credit at the same time, if that makes sense, about being that big guard. Because my nickname with San Antonio when I first started with them was Butch, like a butcher.
Right.
He's like, you're like a butcher. You go in there and it's like, da, 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 da. And I'm like, hey, man, these guys, I don't know what you want me to do. These guys are moving so fast. Sometimes you just got to foul them. And he's like, hey, Devin, we have no problem with that. I said, okay.
Now, was it PJ who gave you the nickname Butcher, or did you get that from somebody else?
No, that was PJ.
Oh, okay. Because he was
PJ
great.
Carlissimo.
One thing about PJ, and you and I worked with him closely for a number of years, but yeah. He would always give everybody a nickname. I became Philly Billy because I'm from Philadelphia. To this
That's
day,
right.
Dev, here it is, 2023, 22 years later. People still call it Matt Bonner. I saw him in the hallway just a little while ago. Hey, Philly Billy. So
yeah.
And PJ is one of those guys that gives everybody a nickname. So and he'll call you Butcher till the day you die. You
realize
that's that?
It. Yeah. The last time I saw him, he did. Yes. The last time I'd been out of the league. 10 years. Yeah.
That's great. We should try to get PJ on the show because he's got a bunch of stories. I didn't realize this until I was looking at your bio up that they actually retired your number with the Kansas City Cagers.
They did.
Not only did you have your number retired at UTSA, and I don't know anybody that had their number retired by the KC Cagers, but now I do.
Well, I remember getting that phone call and going back for the ceremony. That was exciting. I mean, that's, you know, like I said, that's one of those 3-month leagues. You know, played well. I was a young guy, fresh out of college, didn't know anybody. One of the, the big keys to being in a situation like that is, you know, not so much like UTSA, but sort of. But these are grown men that have been trying to play for years. And I mean, you're out there in the USBL. They'll give you a minivan with two guys you barely know, and we might have a game in Long Island. And there was no Google back then, so we had to stop and get a map, and we had to map this thing out. And I remember getting on the road, and that's what makes you appreciate the career that I had, when you have to go through experiences like that. Because I'll tell you what, I've been around a couple of teams. I'm not naming any coaches. I'm not naming any players. But if that plane was 5 minutes late and we were going to Miami or New York or Los Angeles, oh, they were yelling at somebody.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because, Bill, you've been around the league a lot. You know, there's certain cities you want to get there on time.
Yes.
And so when that plane is late, or if they feel like we've been de-icing for, you know, not our regular 45 minutes, 2 hours, going on 3 hours, it becomes a problem.
Yep. Yeah, because you're trying to get from point A to point B, right?
Yeah, you got to get point A to point B. And if we are scheduled to get in Miami at 4:30, that plane better be there at 4:32 at the latest.
Yep. Hey, so let's get back now. You're paying your dues, and then
right. You
get a chance to get back to the NBA. And I know that had to be a real thrill for you because, like I said, you're doing long bus rides. You're going out to Long Island in a van with guys you don't know. So
right.
you got other stuff going on, and you had a little taste of that NBA.
Yeah.
Now you want to get that back, right?
Now you want to get that back. Speedy Claxton drives the ball to the basket, lands on his shoulder, busts his shoulder up. My heart, when I'm watching the game, my heart stopped, you know, for a little bit, and then the phone rang. And I'm like, no way. Yep, they called me back. So, you know, you come back, 10-day contract, and you got to make the most of it, right?
Sure.
And, you know, I did. I was able to do that. But that's what it is. You know, you got to – whenever you play in the D League or G League, whatever it's called now, you got to be ready for that phone call because you just never know. You just never know.
Now, was that during the 2003-04 season or the 2004-05 season?
No, 2003-04 season.
Okay. That was your first year when you came back. Okay. And you got a chance to play some there. And then, of course, you know, you're, the next year is a championship season, and you're with some guys that can really play some lockdown defense. And, you know, during that period of time, the Spurs obviously were the best team in the league,
right,
the most consistent team in the league. And if it wasn't for the 0.4 shot against the Lakers with Derek Fisher and the and one in 06 for Nowitzki, there's a chance of like five in a row there. So
yeah, there
that's
is.
That's how
close
the Spurs came. But you were on that championship team at 05. What do you remember about that season in particular, Devin?
Just the preparation every day. Every day with San Antonio was a business-like atmosphere as far as, you know, Pop wanted to make sure that all the new guys, and we didn't have a lot, but we did have some, that you were ready down the stretch. So film sessions, it was a lot of film that year, being that we were breaking down what it is that the Spurs do defensively, okay? Because in the playoffs, you don't have time, you know, to try and do a whole lot of teaching. So, you know, that year, it was a ton of film. And so, you know, I don't know if you remember, but losing that first game against Denver, game one, we had a players only meeting, and Robert Horry got up and addressed the team. And that kind of set the tone after that. After that, we got rocking and started playing a whole lot better. And obviously, we know what happens in the end. But, you know, even that game in Detroit, you know, Pop went to Rob late in that fourth quarter. And, you know, we had to help him up. You know, he was as stiff as a board over there. But I'll tell you what, that 6 minutes that he played, they were huge. You know, he has the big left-handed dunk, big three, defensive stop. And, you know, that's why you see you don't see a whole lot of it now these days, you know, keeping veterans around like that. Mm-hmm. But at that time in the NBA, that's why guys like that were given an extra year, not for 82 games, for one or two games. And that's what Rob did.
It happened a couple of years earlier, too, with Steve Kerr. Late
that's right.
Year. He wasn't playing very much, but, you know, when they needed that 3-point shot late, that's one thing that Steve could do. And Rob, of course, could do the same thing. That 3-pointer in game five was obviously a pivotal shot, I thought, in the series. But, man, what a series Manu had in
exactly.
the finals. What do you remember about playing with him?
Manu cost a lot of people their jobs. I'll just tell you that. During the summer, there would be a lot of wing players that came in, you know, that San Antonio had their eyes on. And a lot of times we would sit back and, you know, Manu would just come into town and you'd see him go against like six or seven, you know, legit wing players, guys that had bounced around in the NBA or they were just trying to make their way in the NBA. And I'll never forget, Tim would just sit there and he would laugh because he's like, none of those guys are going to make the Spurs roster because they have Manu with Manu and these guys going one-on-one, you know, for these guys trying to get an invite to the Spurs camp. And the problem is that, you know, Manu's up there working on his game against all these guys. So we saw a lot of different things out of Manu. Never knew, you know, going in, you know, you think when you're playing an 82 game schedule, you would see, you know, some of the same stuff. And it seemed like he would come out there with a different, you know, part of his bag every single game. And that's what made him unique.
Yeah. I had a chance to be in Springfield last year when he was inducted in the Hall of Fame. And because I had seen every game he played for 16 years, you know, Dad.
Right.
And the love that the opponents showed him. And the different people that I got to see up in Springfield that were from different organizations. And it was respect, not only, I think, for Manu and for the Spurs, but also for the international game and the way that these international players, Dev, you know, have really kind of changed the game, especially now recently. But Manu was one of the first guys to really make an impact.
Yeah, he did. And you know, he's setting the table for these guys now. And they're doing a great job of bringing, you know, meshing in what it is that they do in the NBA and then what it is that they bring, you know, from their side. And, you know, it's a beautiful thing. Right. And so, you know, Manu kind of set the table for that. And he was definitely tremendous in both on and off the court, by the way. And so, you know, again, congratulations to him on that. And, you know, he was quite a player.
Do you stay in touch with any of your old teammates from the Spurs, Dev?
You know, I'll run into him. Tim with volleyball. My daughter's playing volleyball now. Bruce, you know, Bruce is over at TMI. That's right up my alley. Mm-hmm. You know, because I'm, you know, I do a lot of recruiting with high school players. So I see these guys, you know, quite a bit. And, you know, I'll come to Spurs games and I'm walking around in the back and, you know, I'll see some old coaches and things like that. And so I probably need to do a better job of keeping up with them, but I have a ton going on myself. So I kind of just, I'll say hi and bye. We'll talk and things like that.
Well, let me ask you about what you're doing. Obviously, you're coaching. You've got your pro skills shirt on.
Pro skills shirt, yeah.
Yeah. Bring us up to date with what you got going on in your coaching career.
So we have a basketball organization, Nike Pro Skills, here in San Antonio. And I look for is under-the-radar kids that want to do what I did. You know, you can't do it by yourself. Obviously, there's going to be some great players, and we have some great players around town that just don't have the exposure that they need. So we have our organization about 300 kids right now. We have 23 teams. We take them around Dallas, Houston, California, South Dakota. We go everywhere. We get them on that platform that they need if they want to play at the college level.
Mm-hmm. I see these are mostly high school age kids, Dev?
Yeah, well, I mean, we start from kindergarten to 12th. Mm-hmm. But when you start talking about travel basketball, when it comes to that level, we kind of want to keep it 7th grade and above. If that 7th grade team is ready to, you know, start getting into Dallas and Houston, because, you know, I'll be honest with you, Bill, they got some monsters, you know, in Dallas and Houston, not only, you know, Vegas, they got them everywhere, but 8th grade and above for sure. But our 7th graders, they've been doing a great job. If we feel come March that they're ready, then they can join the club too. But I coach three of our top high school level guys, our unsigned seniors. Mm-hmm. You know, we give them, 2.5 months, a couple of live periods to get that one last look, you know, before you may want to, you know, do something else. I coach our top 24s. We're looking forward to seeing what they're going to do this summer. That's going to be one of my teams. And then we're going to do a combo 24-25. Now, when I'm shouting these numbers out, this is the when they're graduating class in high school. Mm-hmm. All right. So our top 24-25 team, they're going to be really good. We got some 25s, sophomores that can really play. And we're going to make sure that, you know, what we say in our business right now is we're going to give them an NBA type schedule. Like, we're going to put them in places that they need to be and on that platform so we can get their name out there.
Yeah, put them to work, right? I mean,
we're going to put them to work. That's right.
The hard work.
That's right.
Where did this passion come for you from coaching, for teaching?
Yeah, I'll just say a name, LJ Brown. That's my son. He graduated in 2021. We had been playing with a couple of teams around town, and, you know, I've been through it, Bill, and I knew at some of the gyms that we were going to and some of the, you know, teams that we were playing against, I said, I think there's a little bit more out there, but I couldn't find it at the time. And he called me one day and he told me about this program. And, you know, when you're making a switch like that his junior year, you know, I didn't want to do it. But we did, and I'm glad that we did, because now he's playing college ball. He's there in Dallas playing. It's one of you have to have that platform to get to where you're at, Bill, and be around those players that you're at. You have to be on the rap platform. You cannot as an organization, you cannot just play in San Antonio during the summer. That's not going to work. You have to get these kids out there because, you know, a lot of these kids for a seventh grader, for an eighth grader, for a ninth grader, they've never seen someone 6'10" at 15, 16 years old. You see what I'm saying? And so that's my passion, is to get them out there. That way, when we get back to San Antonio, you go, coach, now I know what it is that I need to work on. Right. And so that's what we're trying to do for these kids.
It's great to see the passion that you have for the game carried over to you as a coach and presenting it to these young guys. Dev, we've asked all the guests on the show about the legacy of the Spurs. Of course, you're a San Antonio native, so you probably have a little different perspective, but it's the 50th anniversary of this year. And of course, we're doing this big celebration all year long, having guys like you on the show. And Mike Kikarilla, our director of broadcasting, is producing this wonderful documentary, a series of documentaries. So we're having a lot of fun with this. But when you think about 50 years for the Spurs, first few years, of course, the ABA, and now 50 years overall, and the Spurs' impact in the NBA and on basketball, what would you say that that would be?
Yeah, well, I'll answer that like this. In high school, you know, you never, you know, really heard about any negative things about the Spurs when it came to off the court stuff and what they brought to the city of San Antonio as far as basketball. It gave us pride, and it gives me pride now, because I'll tell you what, when I walk into the gym for, you know, some of these tournaments that we go to, and let's say they're in Dallas, let's say they're in Houston, it is, I'm a Spur. It's the Spurs versus Rockets, right? And I might have these 16-year-olds, but they will tell you, I walk in there and I'm like, we don't lose to them. We don't lose to them, all right? That's what it was. That's what it is for me now. You know, in college, the same thing. Those guys would come out and play pickup with us, and they just had this deal about them where, you know what? We're going to come in here and we're going to show you why we're the Spurs and you guys are Roadrunners, right? The little game within the game. Mm-hmm. And then to be a part of it, to see it every day, to walk in, to see Pop and the passion that he had, a guy like myself, and I say it all the time, man, whatever Pop wanted me to do, I would do. And whether it was running through a wall or guarding, you know, somebody I had no business guarding, as far as, you know, Shaq or whoever, I'm like, yes, sir, I got it. I'll go do it. So when you wrap this thing up in 50 years, it's just the pride that we have being a native of San Antonio, and the fact that it just, to me, it's excellence. And the Spurs have done a great job, not only on the floor, but off of the floor. And, you know, it's something, it's a pride that I carry with me now. So very happy to see all the different phases of it. You know, just real quick, in 99, when they won, I was downtown walking Commerce Street, and it was a lot of people down there. And to see that, you know, it just fuels that fire in you. And so some of those dark days I had when I was in the G League and things like that, I remembered those nights. I remember the night of 05, you know, driving in the Hummer down, what was that, 35? And I'm high-fiving out the window, driving on the shoulder. Now, nobody tell the police that. But anyway, that was a long time ago. But I'm high-fiving people on the highway, you know, and that's the passion that San Antonio has about, you know, their San Antonio Spurs. Bill, I remember being hurt and Tim invited me to his house to watch the game, and I turned him down because I always wanted to know what it felt like to watch it at one of your local sports bars, a road game, when you were actually on the current roster. And when I got hurt, I did that.
Wow.
And it's not only is it like one, But around the city, when the Spurs were going really good, I mean, I know they have an idea because, you know how it is. You come back from the airport after a huge win. There's 1,000 people out there. But around town, the passion that there is for the San Antonio Spurs at all these different bars, the watching parties that are all around the city, it's amazing. So, you know, from someone that's been on both sides of it, you know, I personally, I'm saying thank you, you know, to the organization. And then, you know, with me being a part of it, yeah, man, it's a lot of passion that comes with being, you know, a San Antonio Spur and a San Antonio Spurs fan.
Devin, we certainly do appreciate you taking the time to join us for the podcast. Hope to see you down the line at a future game for sure. And continued success with Pro Skills. I know that you're doing a great job with that. And we hope to see you again very soon, okay?
Hey, thank you for having me. And you will definitely see me. We'll be there in the Dome on Friday.
Okay.
And, you know, thanks for taking the time. And I really appreciate it.
Okay, thank you. That is Devin Brown, our guest, Sound of Spurs podcast, the homegrown Spur. Devin Brown, presented by HEB. We'll see you next week.